Institute, and we're going to begin the program now with our superintendent of Tuskegee Institute National Historic Site, Tuskegee Airmen National Historic Site, and the Summerton Montgomery National Historic Trail, Sandra Taylor.
Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
It's nice to see this nice crowd on a rainy day. Yeah, this is really nice. I just want to say to you that we're so excited that we're reopening the Carver Museum. It's been a while. I remember when I first met with Dr. Roshan and he had over at the cafeteria, but over at the restaurant. That is the most ugly group over there. What is it that you can do about it? And it's not easy to get money for these projects, I'll tell you. But we were able to get money and we were able to redo the roof for the Carver Museum. We were able to get the money to do a new elevator, to make some condition changes inside. And then through our partnership with Tuskegee University and the Chicago Field Museum, through the support of Hillary Hansen, who was their curator, we were able to loan some of our artifacts. And they built an exhibit that had traveled through a couple of cities around the United States and ended up at the Carter Library in Atlanta. And we had the privilege to be there with Mrs. Carter and President Carter while the exhibit was there. It was a really phenomenal evening. And so as a result of that, we were gifted these some of these exhibits, and now you have this on the road to being finished laboratory here for Dr. Carver. So what a great way to honor him for his 150th birthday. I would also like to say that we intend on doing some additional renovations to the site. When you think of Dr. Carver, and I was reminded about this by my good friend Toby Warren, is Dr. Carver was not just a brilliant scientist or a wonderful educator, you know, or a phenomenal conservationist, but he was the most one of the most dynamic human beings to walk the earth. You talk about a civil leader. What a lot of examples from his life that we can take from that in bettering our lives and our relationships with each other. So I really am excited that you have the opportunity with the National Park Service to be part of this expansion of the work of Dr. George Washington Carver, and it is our hope that we will continue to make this a more glorious place as we help move Tuskegee, the city of Tuskegee, as one of the most historic cities in the United States.
Next we have Reverend William Lamar doing the invocation.
What a joy to be in this historic place. If I can bring back memories, I know we long and so surely it also they attended the number one, you know, the microphone. But anyway, we thank God for all of you who are here. Let us bow our heads for a word of prayer. Eternal and everlasting God, the God of all mercies, the God of all grace, we come this morning giving thee thanks, praise, glory, and honor. For thou art our God from everlasting to everlasting. Thou art the same yesterday, today, and tomorrow, with no respect of person. For this and all things, thy praises will continually be in our mouths. Father, we thank thee for all thy blessings, those past, present, and those that have ordained for each of us from the foundation of the world. We beseech thee to forgive us of our shortcomings and empower us by thy merciful grace to walk in the light of thy presence, all to thy glory. Now, Father, we thank thee for this historical occasion, and for the works of thy servant George Washington Carver. And we pray that you will continue to allow those works and those initiatives here at Tuskegee University to be a blessing to the many whose footsteps will trod these sacred grounds. Today we pause to rededicate this facility and the works of thy servant who served here for 47 years. He took little thought of his own needs, but focused on the needs of others with prayer, grace, skill, meekness, and dignity. And we come today to rededicate this edifice in his honor, which welcomes all of us and future generations to come, keeping us ever mindful of the contributions of this humble man, who had his early beginning 150 years ago in Diamond Grove, Missouri, then on to ours, and then here to Tuskegee to begin his ordained work here. Father, may we be ever mindful of his contributions that he shared with Tuskegee, the state, the nation, and the world, without thought of recompense, many times in the wake of racism, hardships, trials, and tribulation. Yet he forged forward with thy mercy to thy glory. Now, Father, we ask your blessing upon all those who are gathered here today at this auspicious occasion. And may we, like Dr. Carver, be the greatest good to the greatest number of people. We ask a special blessing for our speaker. May his words inspire us upward and onward to serve our fellow man as George Washington Carver has inspired all of us. Father, we pray that we may leave these hallowed grounds, that we too may let our light so shine for the betterment of all mankind. Now, Father, we ask our blessings upon our president, upon the offices of Department of Interior, our university president, and all that are present here. And may we pray that the humble dreams and aspirations of George Washington Carver will continue to resonate in our hearts and minds today and down through the years. All these things we ask in the name of the divine creator, the only divine son, Jesus the Christ. Amen, amen, amen. Amen.
Amen. I have a selection from the Tuskegee University Golden Voices Concert Choir under the direction of Dr. Wayne Barr.
Physical from the spiritual. They went hand in hand. Every aspect of his life was involved with God and his creation. He felt like that we are all supposed to be God's garden tenders. And some of the most amazing letters that we have in the archive about him. But also in the archives, we have information about all these wonderful buildings. And it's amazing. You're now sitting and standing in the laundry building. That's what it was originally built for. 1901 to 1915, the laundry was over in Northern Hall, which is now Kellogg. And then it moved here in 1915, where it stayed until 1938, when Frederick Dean Patterson, determined that there needed to be a place to store all of Carver's materials, all of his paintings, a lot of his writings, other various and sundry items, including his laboratory materials. And his laboratory was here. He and Curtis, his assistant, worked here for a period of time. Now, Carver died in 1933, but in 1938, when this building was dedicated to his museum, for his museum and for his laboratory, there was a lot of things that were brought in after that fact. In fact, in 1939, there was a farmer that brought a meteorite to Carver. It weighed 202 pounds. Now, the farmer had found, and this is what tradition says, and you know, that's what was written down, so that's what I have to go with. But tradition says that the farmer found this big rock in his field, and he brought it to Carver. Now, here in Macon County, we have small rocks and sand. He brought this big rock to Carver, and this shows you the brains of Carver. He had probably never seen this meteorite in his life. But he told the farmer, he said, well, that's a meteorite. So that and many other items stayed in Tuskegee's museums for years and years thereafter. Now, in 1938, as I said, Frederick Patterson dedicated this building, or had it designed to move into, and it was dedicated in 1941 when Henry Ford and his wife came down here, and Henry Ford was particularly close to Carver, and they came down here, and they dedicated this as the Carver Museum. Now, many of you don't know this, but that close relationship between Ford and Carver carried on to a variety of different locations. Did you know that there's a laboratory that was completely reconstructed in Detroit? There's also, we found out through our research that Carver had provided stains for Henry Ford's home and his office in Georgia. So they had this close working relationship that was outside of Tuskegee. That says a lot, doesn't it, to the most brilliant men of the time. This, in 1947, a disastrous flood of a fire occurred here in the museum. It destroyed many of Carver's paintings. A lot of his artifacts, though, and his documents were rescued and saved. And they are now divided up between here and the archives on campus. When the building was restored in 1951, it was enlarged by a second exhibit room. This made it possible to have in one place all museum items related to Tuskegee Institute, which they did have over here. I mean, many of you have seen these. And then the rest of it was for Carver's materials. And today, we now see the fruits of this new renovation. And I think it's a glorious one. Sandy, you guys are commended for what you've done here. It really highlights Carver, but also highlights the school. And the school would like to thank you for what you've done in making this a wonderful place and a highlight for everybody to come and visit Tuskegee University. I encourage you all, as you walk through these areas, to think about what all has happened here in Tuskegee. We had a meeting last night. We were talking about all the historical things that have happened in Macon County. And we started naming them off in this meeting. We filled up pages of materials. I mean, everything from the old federal road which passed through here. And by the way, Macon County, General Lafayette from the Revolutionary War stayed here in Macon County. We could go on and on and on talking about the major battles that went on here between the government and Native Americans. The opportunity for resettlement. But we could go on and on after that. Not only we talk about what happened with, and you know, people that come here to the archives, they always talk about the Tuskegee Airmen, the Tuskegee Syphilis Study, which it wasn't Tuskegee Syphilis Study. Had nothing to do with Tuskegee University. Nothing at all. But that's the name that they've given it. They talk about the George Washington Carver, Booker T. Washington. And that's pretty much it. What people don't know is what else has happened here. Because what happened here in 1957? In 1957, because of the work of the TCA and Charles Will Million, there would not have been a 1965 Voters' Rights Act. This place is amazing. The history that's here, and what's unfortunate is many of our young people don't know that history. We have got to work to do things like this, to bring that history to the rest of the world, so that we can magnify Tuskegee's role, and it is a significant role in the history of the United States of America and the world. Thank you.
Yesterday, out at the Skyway Club, We were gathered there at the Tuskegee Airmen National Historic Site, and let's give them a round of applause. But Sammy, I wanted to challenge you, because when your national director was here recently, the gentleman from Washington, he challenged us because the job is not yet finished. We glorify Dr. Carver today. We remember the Tuskegee Airmen, but we cannot forget Dr. R.R. Moten, the second principal of Tuskegee Institute, who had the courage to do the right thing, to make land available, and to stand against the Ku Klux Klan to say that we will have a veterans hospital so that black veterans, just like white veterans, who have served our nation would have no less than the best in terms of medical care. So our work is not over. And here today, on this occasion, as we celebrate the birthday and the recognition of Dr. Carver, we also send out a clarion call to the federal government to declare the Tuskegee VA Hospital as a national historic site, and we want it to also become a national park site, because it was to medicine, in terms of African Americans, what the Tuskegee Airmen were to aviation. So our work is not over. Now, with power invested in me by the citizens of Tuskegee, Alabama, and the City Council, I hereby proclaim this day as Dr. George Washington Carver Day in the city of Tuskegee, Alabama, and I ask you all to please stand on your feet, let the Park Service know how much you appreciate it.
Chief of Interpretation. so we can talk about and strategize how can we get some new artifacts or new exhibit pieces in here. We did that, and really didn't know exactly where we were going to go or how we were going to do it because the funds were not available. But looking at Carver's life and connecting the stories, we do have to understand that Carver was a man of faith. And we needed to use that faith in order to inspire us to take some new steps and to reach out. And we did do that. We reached out and we noticed that exhibit artifacts were coming back from the Chicago Field Museum, and they had prepared a great traveling exhibit that was going around this country, and it was closing. We were able to work with them in order to get the Jessup wagon that you see here. There is a diorama that is on the other side of the exhibit hall here. There's some interactives that you see, and we were able to embed those into the current exhibit that we have today. Now, we do have plans for the future because this is not it. This is not it. We have changed downstairs. It used to be a theater area. We are in the process of changing that into more of a museum that will talk to the larger story of Tuskegee Institute, starting off with Booker T. Washington, and going to Milton, and then following the legacies of the professors and the presidents that worked here and did so many phenomenal things. We are going to have a small area downstairs where we have an additional laboratory. It's a reproduction of the laboratory that Carver used. And we're going to use that to interact with youth so they can get closer to the things that Carver would have been dealing with, and we can explain it in a different way. We also have a temporary exhibit space where within the next couple of months, or weeks or months, we're going to start a rotated art exhibit that we're going to be inviting the public to come in and to see, and also eventually participate in. So we are very proud of where we are, looking forward to the future. We invite y'all to come to Tuskegee Institute National Historic Site, come to the Oaks, come to George Washington Carver Museum to explore this history, but also go to the Tuskegee Airmen site and see that story over there, and also the Summit of Montgomery Trail, which is not too far down the road. Next year, we'll be commemorating the 50th anniversary of the Voting Rights Act. And there'll definitely be a march from Selma back to Montgomery. We're going to invite the world to this region to see that. And to also note what Mr. Chandler has spoken. Without Tuskegee, there will be no Voting Rights Act. So we are part of that trend, definitely in history and on faith. So we'll be working with that. Before I step away from the mic, I do want to recognize our site manager for the Tuskegee Airmen site, Deanna Mitchell. I appreciate you coming over.
Boxer, where he used to shave him with the kids, because of George Lasseter.
be the one to carry him around because he didn't drive. So there's, Oscar said, there's a lot of history here. And I want to ask you a question before I go to the history. You all have seen a movie here recently. And that movie is called The Great Gatsby. What connection does that have with Tuskegee? That's what I'm saying. We need to know our history. The Great Gatsby. All right, there's no question. Who wrote and who wrote The Great Gatsby?
Fitzgerald.
F. Scott Fitzgerald. Where was, where did he live at?
Montgomery.
Where?
Montgomery.
Tuskegee. Married his wife Zelda on Main Street. So we got history here coming out of the, as the author said, that he look at coming out of here. He married his wife Zelda on Main Street. They do have a society in Montgomery, you're right. But right here, in Tuskegee, we have so much. We go on and on and on about everything here in Macon County, shorter and everything else. But time not permitting. But I want you, as the archivist said, to learn more about Tuskegee. Learn more why Tuskegee was not destroyed when we had one of the Varner over here, because he was a roommate of one of the persons who came to Wilson's Raider. Tuskegee was not destroyed. All of this is here in your little town. Don't just spin through like I did. I went to school in Massachusetts, went there and great-grandpa in Massachusetts, and guess what? Came all the way back into Tuskegee, had to find out that I was in the town of guess who? W.E.B. Du Bois was born in Great Barrington where I went to prep school. And I stayed there all those years and didn't know that. So learn about your town, learn about Tuskegee, learn about the Oaks, learn about all that is here. Also, I was mentioning the spirituality of God. I was in Iowa to speak, and I just want to share this with you because you might not see it in any of the books anywhere else. And I was very, very, very surprised to see Gerald. When I went into this little church, and all of them, on this program, it said Dr. Carver's trial sermon. And the floor of me, Dan, I said, trial what? Sermon. He did his trial sermon in Iowa. So that was the reason why some of his spirituality came from. Because number one, he was already committed. Amen? Learn a little bit more about your area, if you will. Now let us give the benediction, all right? All right. Father, we thank you for what our eyes have seen, our ears have heard, and our hearts have felt. We thank you, Lord, for the service of this humble servant that you have sent this way. And not only that, but those here who labor to make these dreams a reality and continue to forge forward in the name of thee and in the name of George Washington Carver, that we might be a help to many as we go forward. Now unto you, unto him who is able to keep us from falling and present us faultless before his presence with exceedingly great joy. To the only wise God be glory and majesty now and forever. Let the redeemed say, amen. Amen.
Hey, Jack.
And with great honor, at this point, we declare that the George Washington Carver Museum is reopened.
These two a round of applause. We're doing an awesome job.
If I may, as you go to explore and to also give refreshments, I just heard Mayor Ford say, what is next? I have an answer for that. What is next? Dealing with our three national parks is the opening of the exhibits at the Selma Interpretive Center in Selma, Alabama. It will be in the coming weeks. We are working on setting the dates. Just look at the newspaper and you'll see the date coming up.
Wonderful. Let's do it.